Johnson again.
1 second. West throws it up. He makes it. West threw it up and makes it. Jerry West made it from the other side of the midcourt strike.
Won't start until it's clutched. They'll have to throw it up. Garhood, turnaround, shot in the air. It's good. It's tied again. I don't believe it. We've got a third overtime in a Boston game.
He gets it out deep and Havlicek scores.
Irving to Cheeks, back to Irving, sets himself from behind the court. It's on time, he made it! Julius Irving with a three-point shot from behind midcourt has won the game for the Philadelphia 76ers.
Here's Isaiah, let's see what we got.
Go!
It seemed like invariably the ball would end up in my hands and I would be the goat or the hero. When you were the hero, everything was fine. When not, you knew that you were going to be criticized for it, and I think I learned to accept that.
In key situations when the crowd was really very emotional, you know, I felt that I could do anything, and most of the time I did.
I don't look to play the perfect game. I don't play for that, but I play for to have that one moment out there where I just take over the game and I know I got control of everything that goes on out there.
It's like you're shooting and you're putting your hand in the basket, and as it goes through, you're taking your hand out. It's an awesome feeling.
It's a feeling Isaiah Thomas and Bernard King would share in the opening round of the 1984 playoffs. The two superstars would raise each other's game amid the sweltering heat of Joe Louis Arena in a fifth and deciding contest that would be remembered less for its outcome than for the tenacious way in which it was played.
I explained to you how hot it was. I had to take off my coat because I was through my shirt and through my coat, and we didn't even get going yet. He has the flu. We are thinking questionable for this game. He's playing with two splints because he had dislocated fingers, dislocated middle finger on each hand.
Well, you're looking at one of the most spectacular players in the game, a person who has abilities that surface at crucial times.
But it was King who would surface first, soaring above the Pistons' swarming defense and scoring at will.
Here's King!
Shattering Elgin Baylor's five-game playoff scoring record along the way.
I was at the point, I was beside myself. I would say we tried at least three or four people, and in many instances, doubling people, but it really didn't make any difference because he was going to get his no matter what.
But while King was unstoppable, Isaiah was slow in getting started, and the Pistons struggled to stay in the game.
Because up until a minute and 30 seconds, he was having a subpar performance. But the gong went off.
Isaiah's got it back from the top. Yes!
What happens? He clicks on, and all of a sudden, the ball is his, the game is his.
Isaiah in a hurry.
With a minute and 45 seconds to go, we're up double figures. Isaiah Thomas has been held by Rory Sparrow and Darryl Walker, and all of a sudden, Isaiah goes off, scores 16 points in 1 minute and 33 seconds.
And the foul!
You say, my God, did I see this or am I dreaming this? I think everyone knew pretty much it would get down to these two people. King was pretty consistent all night at being spectacular. Isaiah picked the moments.
Puts the defense to the hole.
Yes, he did. Hubie Brown's up off the bench going crazy.
We were fouling him when we shouldn't even foul him. The magical players, the Isaiah Thomases, answering the bell. They demand the ball. The players who are playing with them feel the electricity.
Knicks need to call timeout.
But in that fourth quarter, and then into the fifth quarter, Bernard King just would not let us lose.
As King over Curta. Yes! Bernard King!
Those great individuals that we have in the league, the Magics, the Birds, the Bernard Kings, the Isaiah Thomases, have some special way of getting to other levels.
Well, when you take the heat,
cast a Lampier on top by Isaiah, three-pointer. Oh!
And the pressure of the game.
Lewis went up with the left to King. What a sensational rebound.
I've had people say to me that they thought that it will go down as one of the five greatest games ever played in the NBA.
They battled into overtime. Albert King, Barkley for three! Oh, no!
Jordan, no timeout. Michael into the front court. Left corner shot by Jordan. Good! Oh! Oh!
Oh! Harper. Hard line with 1 second to go!
Comes in to Tucker. Ewing sets a screen. The shot is off. Loose ball. Ewing goes up. The basket counts! Sampson.
Three seconds left. Out to Doctor. He's got a crack at it. Three-pointer. He got it.
Rebound, Day. Day with 5 seconds into the front court. Goes to Malone into the corner. Malone throws up a brick left side. Oh, oh my goodness, what a shot. Oh!
Popped away. Loose ball with 15 seconds, and Johnson has it. And he throws up a prayer.
And he good.
Magic Johnson throws up a prayer.
Magic Johnson has had more than his share of opportunities to celebrate last-second heroics, but his first lesson came from the master of such ceremonies.
The first game we played during Magic's rookie year was in San Diego, and I was able to hit a long hook shot at the buzzer to win the game. Magic was so fired up and enthused about it. You know, he was like he had just won the world championship.
I just went crazy. I ran and jumped in his arms and hugged him. And it was just a great feeling.
And I was like, geez, we can't be at this emotional pitch for the whole season, or we won't make it to Thanksgiving.
I said, okay, big fella, I'm sorry. You know, I just got excited. You know, Kareem hit the hook at the buzzer and I'm going crazy. And you know, his expression was, hey, look, no more.
No one has made more pressure shots or more NBA history than Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. In the 1974 finals, his Bucks trailed the powerful Celtics 3-2. Facing elimination in Boston Garden, Kareem used his devastating skyhook to erase an early Celtic lead. And the pressure built as every shot became a big one. Every chance to seize an advantage crucial, and every missed opportunity, a potential turning point. The Bucks built a small lead of their own, and it was the Celtics' turn to respond, led with reckless abandon by Dave Cowens. With the score knotted again, neither team could hold the advantage as they battled through regulation and into overtime. True to their tradition of last-minute heroics, the Celtics got stronger as the game grew longer, and the Boston faithful expected a familiar outcome. But this game would be determined not by who wanted it more, but rather by who got there first. The game would eventually journey into a second overtime as the two teams continued to trade leads and heroes. John Havlicek was torrid in the clutch for Boston. And the legendary Oscar Robertson was the perfect complement to Kareem at the other end of the floor. The pressure of the game brought out the best in both teams as the lead would change hands 11 consecutive times. We'll be right back. But with time winding down, the balance suddenly shifted as the Celtics' fiery leader Dave Cowens fouled out. And insult was added to injury as little-used Mickey Davis hit to put the Bucks up by one. But Havlicek would deliver yet again, and Boston regained the lead. The game had seen everything but an ending, and with 7 seconds remaining, it would be up to Kareem to provide one. As he hit the hook, as it would later be called, the victory went to the Bucks, and another chapter of NBA history belonged to Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. In 1982, Atlanta trailed Milwaukee by one. The Hawks inbound the ball, but Atlanta's hero would turn out to be the Bucks' Harvey Catchings, who knocked the ball into his own basket at the buzzer, giving Atlanta an incredible but true victory. When Kareem Abdul-Jabbar and his Milwaukee Bucks took the floor against the New York Knicks, leading 86-68 with 5:50 remaining, their thoughts were of running out the clock on a certain win. But their 86th point would be their last. And as missed shots piled up, this suddenly bizarre contest had their full attention.
Rebound, Jabbar, no good. Gives to DeBuscher, long jump. Yes! 86-81! Look at my rabbit, fast break. Gives to Monroe on the right. He pulls up. Here's the jump. Yes! 86-83! Slide is on the line. He can move it within one. It is now to one. So Allen will go to the line. He is a very good foul to the 91%. The first. Under. He missed a clutch free throw. Now the second. It is up. No good! Rebound lead.
Thirteen years later, history would repeat itself. The Philadelphia 76ers appeared to be cruising to an easy victory over the Washington Bullets in Game 1 of their playoff series. Leading by 17, with just over 3 minutes left on the clock, the game seemed sewn up. But nobody told the Bullets. Following Sedale Threet's foul shot, Philly would not score again. And as Washington gained momentum, the game and the 76ers began to unravel. The Bullets reeled off an unbelievable 15 straight points to pull within two. And though their efforts seemed destined to be wasted as Dr. J stepped to the line, the Bullets still had one more miracle left.
Here's the play. Dudley Bradley has the ball launched. Good. And it counts. Oh, my heavens. The most unlikely guy in all of basketball to shoot that shot fires it as the clock expired.
Who did the Bullets look to in the clutch? If it's Game 1 of the 1979 Finals, the answer is Larry Wright. Unfortunately for the Supersonics, this unheralded reserve guard could seemingly do no wrong.
Bobby Dandridge will inbound and under Larry Wright, puts it up. No good! But a foul was called on Dennis Johnson, I believe. A foul is on Dennis Johnson with no time on the clock, and they're going to let Larry Wright go to the free throw line. A foul on Dennis Johnson, no time showing on the clock, so all Larry Wright needs to do is make one, and the ball game is over. Pressure, but he's been thriving under all afternoon.
On that day, Larry Wright shed his anonymity and stood alone in the spotlight.
Now it goes to Kareem.
But sometimes the glare of the spotlight becomes harsh, on its would-be heroes.
10 seconds. Ellis. They bring it down to the last shot. They don't want to give the Lakers a trip. Lakers don't want to foul. 2 seconds.
That's another time.
He's going to run out. Regulation has ended. Derek Harper didn't know how much time was left on the clock. We're headed for overtime in Dallas.
I tell you what happened, Brett. Harper thought they were leading the game by 1 point because he was running out the clock. I bet he thought they were leading the game by a point instead of the game being tied because he ran the clock out and he thought right then that Dallas won the game.
Well, after that particular play, I don't think people expected to hear from Derek Harper again. I think they expected me to jump off of Sears Tower or something, just go crazy, you know what I mean? But life isn't that way. I think the important thing is when you make a mistake is that you learn from it.
Dallas has got the ball with 19 seconds left, down by a point.
Do you have the nerve to say, I'm going to pull the trigger with about 3 or 4 seconds to go? If it goes in, we win. If it doesn't go in, we don't.
Harper with the ball against Cooper. McGuire drives, misses it. Ball is free on the floor. Harper for three. He got it! He got it with 3 seconds to go! Lakers will call time, down by two, and Derek Harper has done it!
When vengeance is the inspiration, redemption only comes with victory. The 1981 Eastern Conference Finals were here and back to wage their annual war with the arch-rival Boston Celtics and Philadelphia 76ers. From the opening tip, the usual carnage ensued as the Sixers fought to a 2-1 series lead. Philadelphia continued to take it to Boston in the Spectrum, and with their fast break-in gear, they had the Celtics on the run and seemingly on the ropes as Bobby Jones' last-minute interception preserved the win and gave the Sixers a commanding 3-1 series lead. But though on the verge of elimination, Boston was not about to concede.
They have to beat us 4 times. Just don't look at it any other way than that. One of these two great teams has to lose 4 ball games, and until we lose that 4th one, we're still in it.
After leading the Celtics to a Game 5 victory at home, Larry Bird took Game 6 into his own hands as momentum and the bounces were suddenly going Boston's way. The Celtics had broken their 11-game Spectrum losing streak and possibly the Sixers' backs.
We felt it really shocked them and really tore them apart because now it's 3-3 and we're coming back to the Garden. And that was just a game whoever had the most guts and the most determination was going to win that game.
The doctor was determined not to let the series slip away, and the Sixers began the game with fire in their eyes. But Bird quickly doused the flame as he refused to be denied. Boston was within one with seconds remaining, and as the Celtic defense shut the Sixers down, Bird once again came up with the ball. The Celtics had one final chance. It was all Bird needed. And it was desperation time for Philly.
Bobby Jones is going to put the ball in the play. And the pass hits the top of the backboard. And it's over. It's over. It was an alley-oop play. And Boston was down to the series. They won 3 in a row. They came from 3-1 down. And they have won the series. It's all over. It's all over.
A year later, the Celtics found themselves in the same predicament. Trailing the 76ers 3-1, they were once again looking for divine intervention. But Philly was confident that lightning couldn't strike twice. Could it? But with every Celtic basket and every Sixer misfire, it was becoming apparent that last year was more than just a memory. As they ran Philly out of the Garden, Boston had momentum and history on their side. Philly looked homeward for salvation. And they found temporary refuge in an early lead, But as if on cue, Bird and McHale led a second half charge. The nightmare was recurring. And as the Celtics celebrated in Philadelphia, the Sixers agonized over returning to Boston and the ghosts of Celtic past. As Game 7 began, Philadelphia raced off quickly to their customary early lead. But this time they would refuse to relinquish it. And as it became clear that Philly had finally earned the right to move on, Boston Garden echoed with a stirring tribute. The Sixers would advance to play the Lakers in the finals. And although their celebration was a year delayed, for Julius Erving and his Philadelphia 76ers, redemption could not have been sweeter.
Misses a follow and Spiro comes out running. Unbelievable!
Bagley at the buzzer.
Oh, shot by John Bagley!
1 second to go.
To Herb, and he throws the ball all the way down the court. He made it!
In it comes to DJ. Little coast-to-coast job is good!
Hornacek, first two of the game.
Oh! Oh! Help the hoop!
The place was Madison Square Garden. The year was 1970. Laker Goliath Wilt Chamberlain joined fellow superstars Elgin Baylor and Jerry West in search of LA's first NBA title. But the New York Knicks had a quest of their own.
It was whether a group of individuals who really shared and who compensated for weaknesses and shared strengths could be the champions.
The awesome task of stopping Chamberlain fell on the broad shoulders of Willis Reed. And the battle raged as the team split the first two games. In Los Angeles, the struggle continued as they remained deadlocked into the waning seconds of Game 3.
Seven, six, five, the Busher shoot. Hit with 3 seconds to go. 2 seconds, 1 second. West throws it up. He makes it.
Fans run out all over the floor. I mean, just chaos for a while. And the thing that Dick Barnett said to all of us when he came to the bench, he said, because we guys were kind of down a little bit, he said, what's wrong with you fellas? He said, this game's not over. It just started.
Taking their teammates' words to heart, the Knicks stole back the momentum and the series lead. But the Lakers won easily in Game 4, and back in New York, put the Knicks in a 15-point hole that was about to grow deeper.
Top of the key to Reedy's triple team falls down. We got a whistle on the play, and Willis is hurt.
Willis was our leader. He was the big man. He was the enforcer.
Willis very slow to get up.
We thought it was over, naturally, because he was the only big guy we had that was capable of controlling Chamberlain.
The that is for Willis Reed, and it is now a standing ovation.
I can never forget, the fans never once sat down. Everybody stood up. I mean, everybody was standing up when Willis got hurt and they took him out. Well, I don't think he ever got off the feet the entire game. Our juices were flowing.
Rallying around their fallen captain, the Knicks hounded Chamberlain, swarming him on every possession and clawing their way back into the contest.
Rebound off the backboard by DeBuscher. Down court, on the drive, all the way, running, hook, DeBuscher, dribbling. Dennis loses the baseline. He's ahead of the field. He's down the lane. Scoops, and hit. Across the mid-court line, top of the key, cross court by him from 20, he jumps, yes! And the Knicks trail by one! As he drives left, picked up by Chamberlain in the corner, outside Bradley, one-hander from 20, yes! We're tied at 87! Late side, Stallworth, he sets, now drives on Chamberlain, past the basket, Maketa's good! This must go down as one of the great games in the history of the New York Knicks.
But when the euphoria faded, the Knicks were left with the sobering reality of facing the Lakers without Reed. And with the Garden's divine inspiration 3,000 miles away, Game 5's magic quickly became a distant memory as Chamberlain shredded them for 45 points. The Knicks were left looking to Game 7 for another miracle.
DeBuscher came back and I was laying in the locker room on the table. He said, hey, big guy, I said, if you can give us 20 minutes tonight, we're going to win it. He said, it's ours, you know. And I said, Lord, I just hope I can go out there. I mean, you know, for all the years I've been in basketball, this is where I wanted to be. This is the time, the moment, the place, not quite the condition.
The big question is, will Willis Reed play tonight? There is tremendous doubt.
My decision was if I could walk anyway, you know, I was going to play.
Here comes Willis.
I remember walking out on the floor that night and everybody saying to themselves, well, everything's all right, the captain is here. I said, this is a heck of a predicament to be in, you know, because here I was injured, really, and trying to play against Wilt Chamberlain, who I thought was the greatest all-around offensive big man to ever play the game at that point.
But Willis would not be alone.
The Garden had been transformed into a sixth member of our team and by far the most important member.
Top of the key, off the screen, jump short. Rebounded by Bradley, New York ball, down court to Frazier. Got it by West, left side of the lane, outside Reed, jumps from 20, yes!
When he appeared, we went to one plateau. When the Garden reacted, we went to another plateau. When he hit his first two shots, we were gone.
Inspired by their courageous captain, the Knicks never looked back, closing perhaps the most memorable chapter of this storybook season.
Outside the pusher, in the corner Frazier, he drives, DeMar in for a jump, yes! It is Bedlam here at Madison Square Garden.
It was destined to happen in New York, it was New York's time.
Johnson will bring it in. The Purvis short, back to Johnson from 55 feet. Oh, it's good! He banks in a 55-footer.
Still got a second left.
It goes to Manny, who'll try to retaliate. He does! In the final 3 seconds, a pair of mid-court shots.
Meet Charles Oakley and Michael Cage.
I look at Charles, the same type player as I am. We're blue-collar workers. You know, everybody likes the long jump shot, the dazzling dunks and everything, but the real men and the real dirty work is under the basket.
They're rebounders.
It's not an easy job. You really gotta have determination, a lot of heart, and willing to do it every night.
In 1988, they cleared all opposition from the paint, and as the season drew to a close, they battled only each other for the league's rebounding title. In a blue-collar contest of Can You Top This?
Missed it. Oakley, another rebound. He's got over 30 in the game.
When I got to the game, there was a sign in my locker telling me I needed 28 to win the rebounding championship. And obviously, I'd never gotten 28 rebounds before. I tell you, I got kind of nervous. I had 26 rebounds. I got to 27. Fatigue was setting in. My legs were cramping up. We got down to about 2 minutes to go. Seattle took a shot, missed a shot. I was right under the basket. it was a race down to the finish, and I consider both of us, you know, being champions.
On June 4th, 1976, the Boston Celtics faced the Phoenix Suns in the fifth game of the NBA Finals. Later, many would simply call it the greatest game ever played.
That was the greatest game I've ever been involved in.
I remember it started one day and ended the next. You know, it was after midnight before it was over.
It was like three games in one almost, you know.
Everybody was just exhausted emotionally and physically.
That championship series did not mean nearly as much to the Celtics as it would have meant to the Phoenix Suns.
Heavily favored Boston had grabbed the first two games of the series before being stunned two straight in Phoenix. And as the venue shifted back to Boston Garden, each team was set to battle for the series lead. It would turn out to be a battle no one could have ever imagined. From the opening tip, Boston took control of the contest and quickly built what appeared to be an insurmountable lead. The fast start had Celtic faithful calling for the Suns to surrender and had the Celtics looking for more.
I remember that Boston had us down by 20 or 22 points. We had to call three timeouts in the first quarter. We were really reeling.
But the Suns refused to quit, and their confidence grew as the Celtic lead diminished. As history would later show, this game was far from over. Once Phoenix got close, Boston was unable to shake them. And when Paul Westphal hit this driving three-point play, the score was tied at 94, and the comeback was nearly complete. With 3 seconds remaining, Phoenix had a chance for victory, but Dave Cowens deflected the inbounds pass, and the two teams looked towards overtime, tied at 95.
Going into the first overtime, we actually felt that we could beat them in the first overtime, especially once we came in 20 down.
But it was Boston who struck first. And with Phoenix quick to answer, the chase was on.
There were so many highs and lows. You thought you had it won, and all of a sudden you were elated. Within a second, it would turn around and you felt you were defeated.
As the end of overtime approached, the score was still tied. But this time, Boston would go for the win.
Nelson, he waits. They set it up. It comes to Havlicek. Deep in the corner. Havlicek's shot is not good. Second overtime coming up.
As the two teams staggered into a second overtime, the pace raced faster.
You can feel the tension in the Garden start picking up and picking up.
It was a lot of tremendous individual plays in those overtimes.
By the end of the second OT, the challenge came not only from each other, but from within.
15 seconds to go, Phoenix down by one. Here's a steal by Westphal to Van Arsdale, to Perry. It won't go. Perry gets the rebound. Perry from the corner, scores it! Curtis Perry scores it! 5 seconds to go! Oh, I don't believe it! I do not believe it!
But Boston would still have one more shot.
The guy we were most concerned about was Havlicek, and we wanted to have help, and I'll be a son of a gun if he didn't break loose.
He's coming around to the left. The shot is good! The shot is good, and that's it! The ball game's over! Hold the ball! The Celtic fans are going bananas! The game is not over! I don't think the game is over! There's 2 seconds remaining, I do believe!
I remember thinking that we won, leaving the floor after that second overtime, and realizing that there was 1 second left on the clock, and they brought us back out.
We were down by one, and under the rules of the time, we would have to have the ball out underneath the basket, which makes it almost impossible to get the ball down the floor and get a good shot in 1 second. So we decided to call a timeout.
Heads up call by Westphal to call a timeout and give us the technical.
Bounds on the end line. The shot is good by JoJo White.
JoJo White made the free throw, put them up by two, but we would still get the ball at half court. So instead of being down by one, we'd be down by two, but at least we'd have a chance to tie the game.
1 second remaining in the second overtime.
We had a two-option play, and one was designed for Paul Westfall down in the corner, and the other option was for Curtis Perry to throw the ball to Garfield Hurd up the top of the key.
Nelson stood between myself and the basket, so the only thing I could do was break out to get the ball. And I got a good pass from Curtis, and just kind of like instant reaction, just turn and shoot and hope that you get it off in time.
Won't start until it's touched. They'll have to throw it up. Garhood, turn around, shot in the air. It's good. It's tied again. I don't believe it. We've got a third overtime in the Boston Garden.
And when I took the shot, if I don't know whether it's on the film or not, but I kind of looked over at the official to make sure. And when he threw his hand up in the air, you know, I was just hoping that would go in.
As two physically and emotionally drained teams pushed towards a third overtime, the only thing that didn't suffer was the quality of play. But as night became morning, fatigue was undeniable and Boston's bench became a factor.
The end of that third overtime period, there was a lot of players that were role players, your eighth, your ninth, your tenth people were on the floor playing the nitty-gritty time.
Back out to Havlicek, underneath to McDonald, to fall away. Clay McDonald!
But to counter Boston's depth, Phoenix reached deep inside.
To the credit of our players, they never gave up. I'll say one thing about that 76 team. They refused to quit.
In the final seconds, the Suns again closed within 2 points. And at this juncture of the game, anything seemed possible. But Westfall and the Suns would come up one miracle short. The Celtics would take a dramatic step towards their 13th title by winning the longest game in NBA Finals history. The aura of heroism has always hung heavy in the Boston Garden, where defensive miracles have become a staple of the Celtics' tradition.
Greer's putting the ball on a play. He gets it out deep, and Havlicek steals it over the stand Joe. Havlicek stole the ball. It's all over. It's all over. Johnny Havlicek is being mauled by the fans.
Nearly two decades later, Celtic defense would again haunt its opponent with a method and results equally dramatic.
And now to Magic. Back over to Worthy, and it's picked off. Goes to Henderson, he lays it off and in. It's all tied up. A great play by Henderson.
Henderson's heroics forced game two of the 1984 finals with LA into overtime. Boston would eventually win the key contest and go on to grab its 15th NBA title. And the echoes were once again awakened.
For a minute there, I could hear Johnny Bruce going, Henderson steal the ball!
Through the years, the Garden has witnessed time and again the impossible become the inevitable. Within its walls, would-be challengers are mesmerized by the specter of the Celtic mystique.
All right, Bird is putting the ball on the play, and Dumars comes over to get right on DJ, and DJ gets the pass anyway. All right, 14 seconds left. On the left, it goes to Bird. Bird guarded by Mahorn. Drives around him. Goes on in. And the ball gets knocked out of bounds by Adol. They call it the other way. And now there's a steal by Bird. Underneath the DJ, he lays it in. Right at 1 second left. What a play by Bird. Bird stole the inbounding pass. Laid it up to DJ. DJ laid it up and in. Boston has a one-point lead with 1 second left. Oh, my, this place is going crazy.
They had game 5-1. There's no question about it. They should have won that game. And they forgot about Larry Bird, that's all.
But those who witnessed the 1988 All-Star Weekend would never forget the shooting display put on by one of the greatest pressure performers ever to play the game. His preparation was meticulous. His rhythm precise. And still he struggled. but needing to hit his last three shots to win, Larry Bird depended not only on his skills, but also on his heart.
14. This is a tie. For the money. Yo! Shootout crowd at Chicago Stadium.
Our winner is Larry Bird.
Here's Dennis, gets it in the Bird. Larry, a runner.
Got it! Ball game's over, Boston wins.
Here comes Magic, he's got it, he throws it on the way for three.
Good!
I don't believe it.
Ames to Bird, he gets a good shot in the Celtics winner.
And here's Hanzik with the ball. A three-pointer by Bill. The Notre Dame shot of an air ball, taken by Magic. He throws to the other end.
Again to make the inbounds pass. The double team in Bird. Larry, fake, fall away.
Hits it at the buzzer! All right! Unbelievable.
Grabs it, 5 on the 24, into Worthy. He falls down, makes his arch on Magic. 2 seconds left, Magic throws. It's 3 of it goes! It runs!
2-point Maverick lead.
Bird's the man they want to have it. Yes, indeed.
Bird, 4-3.
Yes! Got it, Larry Bird for 3 with 4 seconds to go. Oh my God! Oh my God!
Bill Russell and Bob Cousy, the cornerstones of Celtic tradition. Elgin Baylor and Jerry West, the nucleus of the arch-rival Lakers. In their inaugural clash, Bob Cousy would dramatically dribble out the clock in the Celtics' seventh game overtime win against the Lakers to give Boston the championship. This would become a familiar pattern as these two teams would meet 5 more times in the 60s. A year later, it was Cousy again who controlled the ball as he closed out his Celtic career with another title at the Lakers' expense. In the team's third meeting, it was Tom Heinsohn's turn to lead Boston past LA and to celebrate his retirement with a victory over the Lakers. As Casey Jones ran out the clock on another Game 7 Celtic triumph over Los Angeles, Red Auerbach puffed on his final victory cigar as Celtic coach. 1968 saw Bill Russell assume the player coach role, but their annual skirmish yielded familiar results.
I just remember the same old story. You know, we just play as hard as we could possibly play and always end up the Celtics on top.
In their final meeting of the decade, fate played another cruel trick on LA as Don Nelson's prayer was answered.
Of all the losses, that was the worst I ever had to endure. I mean, that was something I just simply emotionally couldn't cope with. I think as a player, when you give everything you have and when you're so close, against the same team, you almost feel like an arrogance that they have. And they're sort of laughing at you. And that's the most frustrating thing of all.
As the 1980s arrived, two new protagonists rekindled the rivalry. Larry Bird took center stage.
Full second! Shoot it! Shoot it! Shoot it!
And the Celtics had picked up where they left off in 1969.
Goes into the lane. Jump pass back out to DJ. DJ throws on the top! Boston wins the all-important fourth game!
1985 looked like the same old story, but Kareem Abdul-Jabbar wrote a different ending, and nothing could be sweeter for the Lakers as they finally wrested the title from their longtime nemesis. 2 years later, in the pivotal fourth game, Bird was called upon to resurrect Celtic dominance.
Bird goes to three.
But this was a new era, and Magic Johnson was determined that it would belong to the Lakers. Boston reached back for their traditional heroics, but Celtic magic had run out, and Laker vengeance was complete.
The Lakers have won, and Pat Riley and the Lakers dance off the court.
It was their time. They had established themselves as the team of the 80s.
Out if you have it, if they force a double. Try to get in the lane. Take a look at it. All right, let's go. Come on, let's go. Wait, awesome.
We're going to take it now. Only one shot, baby. One shot.
When the time for talking is over, and those with the courage take destiny in their hands, watch closely, because miracles happen quickly, and heroes are born in the blink of an eye.
All right, Brian Tanner will inbound. He gets it over to the doctor. Tie ball game. Here's a shot, Julius. He scores! He scores at the buzzer!
Bird the rebound, 2 seconds. Bird with a 60-footer up, right through.